Good day, guys. We're going to start our chapter 12. Actually, we started last time, so I'm going to continue from slide number 6. And this is the last chapter that we're going to be studying. Let me share the slide before I forget. So I'm going to go right to the share screen. And this is the screen that I would like to start with, and I hope you can see the screen now. So that's where we were on Monday. We were discussing organic compounds, and we said organic compounds are substances which contain carbon. So they are organic compounds, we said. And organic chemistry is a study of organic compounds and compounds of carbon. So I give you this example where the black ball are carbon and the gray balls are hydrogen. So this structure contains 6 carbons, and if you count number of hydrogen atoms, 3 plus 2, 5, and 2, 7, 2, 9, 2, 11, and 3 is 14. So can I say the molecular formula of this compound I have shown is 14 hydrogens. And we said, if you show the three-dimensional molecule of C6H14, its zigzag structure. Why? Because the carbon in each one of these is tetrahedral carbon. Look at this carbon. Do you see there are 3 hydrogens and 1 bond to another carbon? So this carbon is a tetravalent carbon. And do you remember the structure of a carbon or any central atom, which is connected to 4 atoms, is tetrahedral. And did we say the angle in a tetrahedral is 109? So this angle is 109.5. Here is 109.5. So hexane is not a straight chain molecule, because a straight chain, if the chain was a linear, would have been 180 degree, but the angles are 109. So when we look at the structure of hexane, you show only carbon bond, you see zigzag structure. And in this structure, I'm simplifying. This is shorthand notation for C6H14, where I'm ignoring hydrogens. I assume every beginning of a line, the cross section of 2 lines, another cross section, another carbon, and end of the line is a carbon. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons, which are the same carbon here. I'm not showing hydrogen simply because if we assume all these carbons are tetravalent, that means they have 4 bonds. So I have got 1 bond with carbon here. This is a bond between carbon and carbon. So the other bonds, which are not carbon-carbon bond, there must be CH bond. You already know there must be 3 hydrogens here, which is here. And if I look at this other carbon, there are 2 bonds, 1 bond to another carbon, another bond here. So we need 2 more hydrogens to have a tetravalent carbon. So by using this knowledge, this shorthand notation is convertible to original three-dimensional structure that I showed on the left. So if I go back to this structure and clean up my board, do you see there are 6 carbons
involved, and what is the Greek name for six? Have you heard about hexagon? So hex for six, and the structure of this compound is called hexane. So you show number of carbon in Greek, you add A and E at the name, at the end of the name. A and E simply means that these are alkane. Previously, so A and E is coming from alkane. And previously we said alkanes are saturated hydrocarbons. Why are they saturated? There is only single bond, there is no double bond or triple bond, only single bond. And what did we say about why do we call them hydrocarbon? It simply means they are made out of carbon and hydrogen. Carbon and hydrogen. Carbon. Go back, go back. So does it make sense to have a hydrocarbon which has got six carbons to be hex, and then I add an A and E at the end to show that there is only single bond, there is no double bond or triple bond. So for one carbon, we have methane, you remember this? Methane. For two carbons, we said you call them ethane. I'm not showing hydrogens, so that's ethane, eth for two. And butane means simply there is four carbons, but for four. Every one of these lines which are open, which are not connecting carbon together, are showing a bond to hydrogen. So this is going to be butane. So do you see how I get the Greek name? I add A and E at the end. Example, methane, ethane, propane, propane for three. So it's C3H8, that's propane. So you also had a method of calculating number of hydrogens. In other words, if I say C4, take the four, multiply it by two, you get eight, and add two. So number of hydrogen is number of carbons times two plus two. If I say C7, what's seven times two? 14. You add two, you get 16. So number of hydrogen can be calculated in alkane by simply looking at number of the atoms of carbon. You may remember we said the general formula is CnH2n plus two. That means if you have number of carbons, multiplied by two, add two, you can calculate number of hydrogens. So on the next slide, I show all these Greek names for numbers. We said met for one, et for two, prop for three, but for four, pent like pentagon for five, hex like hexagon for six, hept for seven, oct like octane number for eight, and for nine, we use non, and decade is 10 years, so 10 for dec. And these are the condensed formula of different alkanes. The first 10 alkanes having one carbon to 10 carbons. And if I ask you to name each compound, can I say this has got two carbons, so it must be ethane. Three carbons, propane, that's the gas we are using to do barbecue. They come in cylinder. And this one too, for sex, Greek name hex for sex, and A-N-E. And write the con, if we want to write condensed structure, structural formula for pentane, pent is 5, right? C5. Number of hydrogen, take 5, multiply by 2. You get 10 and add 2, 12 hydrogen. This is the molecular formula, which shows, molecular formula shows total number of atoms. And if I'm going to write condensed structure simply means do not show the bond between carbon and hydrogen, only show carbon-carbon bond. So can I say 5 carbons or 5? And then at the end, we have CH3. At the beginning, we have CH3. All middle carbons already have 2 bonds, so only 2 hydrogens. 2 bonds here, only 2 hydrogens. 2 bonds from this carbon, we need 2 more hydrogens. Here, 1 bond, 3 hydrogens. The end of the chain, 1 bond, 3 hydrogens. So this is the condensed structural formula for pentane. So this is pentane. Ethane, propane, hexane. So these are all saturated hydrocarbon, we call them alkane. And if I go to next slide, what is the name of this compound? So this is a compound which has got branching. This is like a tree here. This is like branching here. If you have branching, first decide what is the longest continuous chain. That would be the name of the parent compound. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons. So can I say there must be pentane? The parent name always comes at the end, pentane here, pentane. And then you have to name branching. Do you remember that I said, if you take CH4, which has got 4 bonds and you can add any more bond to carbon, the name is methane. And this is methane, carbon with 4 hydrogens. Now, what if I remove one of these hydrogens? So what I'm going to have is a carbon which has an open bond for connection. 1 carbon, 3 hydrogens. When methane is converted, when CH4 is converted to CH3, that means losing a hydrogen changes the name, remove A and E at the end, and replace it with YL. So YL means 1 hydrogen is missing. It's ill. YL ill is ill. Why? Because it's missing a hydrogen. That's just something to remember. So can I say I have got 1 methyl group as branching here. I have another methyl group as branching. So we have got 2 methyl groups. How am I going to say 2 methyl groups are sitting as side chain? I say di. Remember? Tri for 3, remember tetra for 4 when we were studying nomenclature of nonmetals. I think it was on chapter 4, I think. You use mono for 1, di for 2, tri for 3, tetra for 4. So di for 2 methyl groups and pentane for the longest continuous chain. It's a parent compound. And where are these 2 methyl groups sitting? I just number the carbons. Can I say one of them is sitting on carbon number two, and I have another sitting on carbon number four? So we must have a number to show location of every branching. If we have dimethyl, which means two methyl group as branching, I must have two numbers here. And numbers are showing the location of branching on the main chain. So I hope this makes sense. So can I say I have got four carbons here, four black balls, and how many hydrogens? Multiply four by two, eight, add two, 10. And if you count hydrogens, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And if I look at this compound, which is branched, the top, we say the top compound is a straight chain. It doesn't have any branching. This does have a branching. This is the parent compound. Longest continuous chain is parent compound. If I look at this, can I say I still have four black balls, which are carbon? And if you have four carbons, you must have 10 hydrogens. You can also count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So these two compounds have same number of atoms, but they have different arrangement of atoms. One of them has branching. One of them is the straight chain with no branching. And we call these, they are different compounds. They behave differently. We call these isomers. So what are isomers? See, we didn't have isomers in whatever we studied from chapter 2 to chapter 11. That was in organic chemistry. Now we are talking about organic compound. Organic compound, they do have isomerism. That means same number of atoms can have different arrangement, therefore different physical properties. That means they have different boiling point, different melting point, also different biological points. That's why when we are dealing with organic compound, we must show the actual arrangements. We must name them based on the arrangement because they are different. Although they have same number of atoms, but they behave differently. For example, guys, what would be an isomer of me? Can I say if you cut my head, place it on my stomach, I have the same parts but different arrangement. So the guy which is isomer of me, which his head on coming out of the stomach is going to have different properties. In other words, if you see me in that form of isomer, you're going to be scared. You won't believe it. You think I'm alien. So our body does the same thing. Biological do the same thing. They look at the arrangement in three-dimensional space. They look at arrangement between number of atoms. Then they behave differently. One of them might be poison. The other one might be a medication for us. That's why when we talk about organic compound, we must mention the name which represents the arrangement of atoms. So two isomers have different names. What do you think would be the name for the upper three-dimensional structure? There are four carbons. Can I say it's butane? On the lower branch compound, how many carbons are there in the longest continuous chain? Can I say three carbons? So this, the name on this isomer is propane because it has three carbons. In the longest continuous chain, it has one branching. What is the name of this branching? Can you help me? Is it methyl? So can I say it's methyl propane? And where, what is the location where the branching is sitting? This is carbon number one, carbon number two, carbon number three. So can I call this two methyl propane? It's a methyl which is sitting on the central carbon, on carbon number two. Two different compounds with the same formula, but different name. That means they behave differently. So if I go to the next slide, I'm going to make definitions. Look at this carbon, red carbon. Can I say this red carbon is connected to how many carbons? Just one carbon. It has one bond with another carbon. It has got three bonds with three hydrogens and one bond with another carbon. So I'm going to call, arbitrarily, I'm going to call this primary carbon. What if I look at the green carbon here? It's connected to two hydrogens, and the other two bonds are connecting it with the carbon on the left and carbon on the right. So can I call this a secondary carbon? So this one is primary. That means it's connected to one carbon, secondary carbon, another green one connected to one on the left, another carbon on the right, two bonds to two carbons. That makes this secondary. And if I look at this red carbon, only one bond to one carbon. So I'm going to call this a primary carbon. What would make a tertiary carbon? Look at this carbon. Is it connected to one carbon, another carbon, two carbons, three carbons? So we call this tertiary carbon. So I'm going to be using these later on, because the hydrogens which are sitting on primary, secondary, and tertiary carbon, they behave differently. They have different properties. So, do you remember I said if CH4 is losing a hydrogen becomes CH3, so you have one bond which is open to be connected. CH4 cannot be connected to another compound because carbon can make four bonds. All four bonds are used already. We said this is methane. Removing a hydrogen makes this methyl. A and E is converted to YL when one hydrogen is lost. And what if I give you this structure, C2H6? Can I call this eth for two carbons, ethane? What would be the name of structure where one hydrogen is removed from C2H6? Could that be ethyl? So ethyl, and I can have propyl, which has one hydrogen less than propane. C3H8, one hydrogen less, C3H7, this is propane. This would make propyl. So do you also remember we call saturated hydrocarbons? That means hydrocarbons which have only single bond. They do not have double bond and triple bond. We call the name of this whole family, doesn't matter how many carbon they are belong to the family of alkane. That's the Arabic name for saturated hydrocarbons. So what would be the name of this whole family of compounds which are missing, which are used to be alkane, they lost the hydrogen? Can I call this family alk? Oops, go back. Alk, alkane. Alkane becomes alk, help me, ill. So alkane losing the hydrogen, they become alkyl. This is the whole name of this family. So I'm going to try to name this. The first question is, what is the parent compound? So take the longest continuous chain. And this longest continuous chain has got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 carbons. So I write the name of the parent compound, longest continuous chain, always at the end. So this is a hexane. It's a derivative of hexane. It has one branching. The branching is not methane, it's methyl, because it's not CH4, it's CH3. So I have a methyl group. And where on this chain is it sitting? Can I say it's sitting on carbon number 3? So I have the name of parent compound at the end. I have to name branching before the parent compound. I have to show the location of branching. So can I call this 3-methylhexane? Now, some of you may wonder, why didn't I number this from left? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. If I use this new numbering system, these new going from left to right, the location of substitution of methyl group is going to be carbon number 4. So the name, I use the same rule, the name would be 4-methylhexane. So because scientists would like to connect together, discuss things from different countries all over the world, they want to make sure the name of same compound, doesn't matter which country is coming from, is the same to avoid confusion. So they say, we don't decide to number from left or right. We number from both sides, we get the names and choose the name which has got smaller location for substitution. So 4-methyl group is not acceptable. Why? Because 4 is larger number than 3. So name from both sides, choose the name which gives a smaller number for location of substitution. So that is the rule. It's neither from left nor from right. It's from sides, which is giving you a smaller location for substitution. And if I go to next slide, this method of nomenclature is called IUPAC nomenclature, which stands for International System of Naming, International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry. So scientists got together, they said we have to make rules. So when somebody name a compound, we know what they are talking about. So everybody is naming a compound the same name everywhere. So I would like to convert a name to a structure. What is the structure of 2,4-dimethylhexane? You remember I said the parent compound, the name of parent compound comes last. So hex means 6, right? 6 carbons. Ane means it's an alkane. It doesn't have double bond or single bond. So what I'm going to do, I write 6 carbons all connected together with single bond. 2, 4, 6. And then we said branching are coming before the parent compound. So this is saying di, what is the meaning of di? Does it mean 2? And 2 what? 2-methyl group, 2CH3. So you have 2CH3. On this 6 carbon chain. And where are these 2 methyls sitting? carbon 2 and carbon 4. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. This is carbon number 2. I am going to place a CH3 on it. And carbon number 4, I'm going to place a CH3 on it. In this case, you don't have to number from left and right. Doesn't matter which side you number, you get the same compound because the other one, the other carbon is going to be 2 for, let's say you go from this end naming. So this is going to be carbon number 2. And carbon number 1, carbon number 3, carbon number 4, carbon number 5, and carbon number 6. So we said 2 and 4. I'm not going to write the hydrogens. You already know how many hydrogens there are on each carbon. For example, you know there is going to be 3 bonds here to make a tetravalent carbon. And here you need 3 hydrogens. Here you need 1 hydrogen, 1 hydrogen, 1 hydrogen, 1 hydrogen, and 2 hydrogens. So every of these bonds which are open are going to have a hydrogen. But why are these 2 identical? Why are these 2 identical? If I take the molecule on below and turn it 180 degrees in a space, I get the molecule above. So when you are going from name to structure, it doesn't matter which direction you number the carbon. But when you are going from the structure to naming, choose the direction which gives you minimum number for location of substitution. All right. For example, what is the structure of 2-methylpentane? So again, look at the end of the name, pentagon, 5 carbons. So I'm going to get 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbon. Ain means carbons are connected together by single bond. And it says 2-methyl, and I'm going to carbon number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Carbon number 2, carbon number 2 has a methyl group, so I place a CH3 here. The rest of it is clear. You need 4 lines, 4 bonds on each carbon. Every bond, which is not between carbon and carbon, they're connected to hydrogens. So you start with CH3, then here you have CH. Sorry, on carbon number 2, you have a CH connected to CH3 right here. And of course, this has to be CH2, CH2, and CH3. So this is the structure of 2-methylpentane. And if I go to next slide, we want to do the same. We want to use the same rule for writing the structure. I want you to stop the video, do this, and come back and see if you got it right. Go ahead and stop it, pause it. Okay, do these sounds right to you? Is that what you got? If not, if these are not making sense, I would really appreciate if you come to my office hours, lab times, ask your question, go to SI classes by Andre, ask your question, make an appointment with a tutor at Science Learning Center, ask questions. This is the time that you have to put all the forces so you can get the best grade on the final, because if your final grade is 10 points higher than second and first exam, is going to replace the scores. Also, final score is going to be used for your third test as well. If you took the third test and your mark was lower, or if you didn't take it at all, finally it's going to be used for your third test. Okay. I already defined isomers for you. They are two compounds which have the same molecular formula, that means same number of atoms, C4, H10 here, and C4, H10 here. One of them is branched, the other one is a straight chain, no branching, so the arrangement of atoms are different. This is H10. But number of atoms are the same, so we call these isomers. That's our definition for isomers. That means, although they have same number of atoms, they have different physical, chemical, and biological properties. So we're asking you, write three isomers of C5H12. So can I say one option is to have no branching at all? So I write five carbons in the row, and I make sure every carbon has got four bonds on it. And each bond, which is not carbon-carbon bond, is CH bond, you place a hydrogen there. That's one option. The next one is, how about having four carbons in the main chain and having one branching? And then you want to make sure all atoms of carbon have got four bonds. And the third option would be, how about having three carbons in the main chain, two branching? So this is option number three, two branching, three carbons in the parent compound. The other one is four carbons in the parent compound, one branching, and the other one is a straight chain, no branching. So this is the structures of, after placing the hydrogens, these are the one that you are going to see. One of them is pentane, five carbons connected together continuously. The other one, four carbons make the longest continuous chain. The parent compound is butane. There is a branching. Branching is a methyl group. And where is it sitting? On carbon number two. So we call it 2-methyl butane. And then next option is three atoms of carbon in the longest continuous chain. So the parent compound name comes last. So it's a propane. It has got two branching, one branching methyl, another branching methyl. How do we say 2-methyl group? Say dimethyl. And we have to show location of this branching. Can I say this is carbon number one, carbon number two, carbon number three? So 2-2 dimethyl propane. Remember, because we have two branching, we must mention two numbers, even if they are on the same atom of carbon. For every branching, you must show the location by number. So this is 2-2 dimethyl propane. So another concept. Guys, if I give you this structure, you're going to call it propane, right? Three carbons propane. But what if I say these carbons are in a different arrangement? They're making a triangle together. They are not open chain, they're closed chain. So if they make a ring, we call it cyclo. So open chain is propane. What would be this cyclic analog? Can I say it's cyclo? Propane. Of course, I didn't write the hydrogen, but you know how many hydrogens there are. Go back. How many hydrogens there are on each carbon? Every carbon is supposed to have four bonds. Same thing here. Three hydrogens, two hydrogens, three hydrogens. So if another way, another shorthand way of showing this, remember when I showed you the zigzag structure, I said, whenever we have a carbon, we use a dot. So a dot for this carbon, and a dot for this carbon, a dot for this carbon, and a dot for this carbon. And the carbons are connected together. So this is shorthand notation for cyclopropane. Why is it good shorthand notation? Simply because by showing a triangle, you know carbon has got four bonds. And if there is no carbon-carbon bond, there must be carbon-hydrogen bond. So you can go from a triangle to this structure, which shows the same as here, cyclopropane. What if I show you a pentagon? You already know it must have pentane because you're talking about five carbons, right? And you see it's a closed ring, you call it cyclo. So this is cyclopentane. If I'm showing this shorthand notation, obviously you remember whenever two lines are crossing, there is a carbon, so five carbons in here. You remember every carbon is supposed to have four bonds. And every bond which is not carbon-carbon must be carbon-hydrogen bond. Sorry, carbon-hydrogen bond. Carbon hydrogen, carbon hydrogen here, carbon hydrogen here, carbon hydrogen here. So do you see this is what you can get from simple pentagon, which is shorthand notation for this structure. What is it? It's CH2. So this is what we are talking about. So this is called cyclopentane. All right. Let me show you a general formula which is different from open chain formula. In open chain formula, we said there is three carbons, number of hydrogens, take three, multiply by two, you get six, add two is C3H8. Let's see how many carbons do I have here. Can I say I have one, two, three carbons? How many hydrogens? Two here, two, four, two, six, H6. So do you see the cyclic formula is C3H6, open chain C3H8. Can I say you have two hydrogens less in cyclic compound from the open chain analog? If I say open chain pentane, you see five carbons, number of hydrogen, take number of carbons, multiply by two, you get 10, add another two, you get 12 hydrogens. How many hydrogens do you see in cyclopentane? Two, four, six, eight, 10. See, two, four, six, eight, and 10. So the open chain is C5H12, The cyclic analog has got 5 carbons, but number of hydrogen are 2 hydrogens less. So what is the relationship between number of carbons and hydrogen in a cyclic compound? Can I say multiply 5 by 2, you get 10? Multiply number of carbon, you get number of hydrogen. Can I say multiply number of carbon by 2, you get number of hydrogens? So what would be a general formula for cycloalkanes? Can I say it's number of carbon simply times 2? So if number of carbons are 3 in cycloalkanes, hydrogens are 6. That in open chain alkane, number of hydrogens were take number of carbon, multiplied by 2 and add 2. 3 times 2 is 6, add 2, you get 8. So open chain alkane, the formula is what? Cn, number of hydrogen, 2 times larger than number of carbons plus 10. But the general formula for cycloalkanes are CnH2n. Do you see the difference? So cycloalkanes are cyclic, they are connected together. You must remove 2 hydrogens so you can connect the atoms together, because carbon is not accepting 5 bonds. Okay. So the shorthand notation, we call it geometric formula. You see a geometry here, right? Condensed structure showing bonding between carbons only. And this is the shape of this molecule in 3-dimensional space. So you have a plane of triangular plane, 3 hydrogens are above the plane, 3 hydrogens are below the plane. This is called cyclobutane because it has got 4 carbon, 5 carbons, cyclopentane, 6 carbons, cyclohexane. And this is how this molecule look in 3-dimensional space. The geometry of molecule in 3-dimensional space is really important for us chemists, because it shows what they can react with and what they are not going to react with. It shows the chemistry. It shows the energy of the molecule as well. But you won't have to worry about that until next higher level chemistry. We don't look at 3-dimensional structure of organic molecule in a space. So you know how to name cycloalkane. We already discussed this. So if I'm going to name this compound, the cyclic compound has got 5 carbons. Can I say the parent compound is cyclopropane? And it has a branching, which is methyl. So can I call this methyl cyclopropane? Why am I not giving a number for location of substitution? Because it doesn't matter if this is here. And if I show another molecule where the methyl is here, they are the same thing. They are both a cyclopentane, which has got 1 methyl, because all these carbons are identical. Carbons in cyclopentane are identical. If CH3 is here or here or here, they are making the same compound. There is one material on a five-member ring. The position doesn't matter. So I don't show a number for this. How about this one? Can I say five carbons, pentane? Closed ring, cyclo. So parent compound, cyclopentane. Is there branching? Yes. How many branching? Two. What is the type of branching method, right? How do you say two methyl use di? So it's dimethyl. Now I have to show locations. Because let's say the two methyl group are not adjacent to each other. What would you name this? In this case, if this is carbon number one, this must be carbon number two because they're adjacent together. So it's 1,2 dimethyl cyclopentane in this case. You may say, why 1,2? You say, why can't I go counterclock numbering 1, 2, 3, 5, 6. So between 1,2 and 1,6 dimethyl pentane, which one has a smaller total? 1 + 2 = 3, 1 + 2 = 7. So this name is not acceptable. Again, you use that rule. Use the rule that you did before. The rule is to have minimum total or a smaller number. If you have one location, depending on the structure, you must have a smallest number. If you have two or three branching, the total must be minimum. What is the name of this one? Can I call this number one, number two? So 1,3 dimethyl cyclopentane. If they have different names, they are different compounds, they behave differently. They're totally different personality, different reactivity, different biological property. And if I'm going to name this, can I say the parent compound is cyclic, has got 6 carbon, can I say cyclohexane is the parent. How many branchings do you see? 1, 2, 3. What is the nature of branching methyl? How many methyl do we have? 3. How do you say 3? Tri. Trimethyl, 3-methyl. Because we have more than one branching, now we have to show the relative location. So can I call this carbon number 1, number 2, number 3, and number 4? There is nothing, no branching on number 3. So my numbers for branching one, two, four, trimethyl, cyclohexane. Please come and see me if these do not make sense to you. You can also read the book. The book is explaining really, really well. So name these three cycloalkane using what you just learned. Please pause the video, get the names, and come back and see if you got it right. Okay, we are back. Did you get these names? 1,2-dimethylcyclobutane-4. One substitution on the ring, and the ring has got 5 carbons, so cyclopentane is the parent compound. The substitution is chlorine, which is chloro. I'm not writing number because all these 5 carbons are identical. Excuse me. Doesn't matter where the chlorine is sitting. Sorry. Parent compound, 6 carbons. Cyclic, closed ring. So cyclohexane, hex for 6. 2 branching. I have to show numbers so you know the relative position. They are not 1,2 because they are not adjacent. They are actually 1,3. But they are not the same branching. One is chlorine, which as a branching would be called chloro. So on carbon number 1, I have chloro. On carbon number 3, I have methyl. Chloro here, methyl here, and cyclohexane. You may say, why not? Starting from here, carbon number 1, number 2, number 3. So why don't I, can I name this as 3-chloro-1-methylcyclohexane? So which is correct? In both cases, the location of substitution is 3+1, which is 4. And here is 1+3, which is 4. So they have identical total. The rule says when you have identical total and you have a choice, number them in alphabetic order. So this chloro starts with C. Methyl starts with M, which takes priority between C and M, alphabetically C. So I start numbering by alphabetic order of the branches. So that is the correct answer, the top one. The lower one is not correct. So let me erase this. Looks very messy. I hope these make sense. If they don't, come and see me, please. So if you stop, pause the video, name these, come back and check. Oh, we just did, actually, sorry. I went to the wrong direction. So this is about cycloalkanes. Why am I going back? I don't know. Maybe I'm confused or tired. Okay. So you already know about isomers. Organic molecules, which have same number of atoms, but different arrangement of atoms. So there is another type of isomerism, which we call it cis and trans isomerism. Cis means on the same side. Trans means on opposite side. Let me give you an example. Suppose I have got a cyclobutane. This has CH3 above the ring, and this one has CH3 below the ring. So I say the relative position of the two substitution relative to the plane of the cyclobutane. They are on opposite side. So this is trans. Opposite side of the plane of molecule. What would make sense, isomer? They're supposed to be on the same side. So can I say cis, plane of the molecule, cyclobutane, one CH3 on the top, and another CH3 on the top as well. They are on the same side. So these are cis on the same side. These are trans, on opposite side. So this is trans. Cis on the same side. Same side of the plane of the molecule. We call them cis. Actually, these two are different compounds. Same number of atoms. Same parent compound. Same substituent. Same number of substitution. By simply having different arrangement in three-dimensional space, they make different compounds. They are going to have different properties, different biological effect, different pharmaceutical effect, different melting point, boiling point, different chemistry. So if I look at these two compounds, can I say both of them, the parent compound is cyclopropane? In both compounds, we have got two branching. And the branchings are chloro. In order to show two branching, I say dichloro, cyclopropane. The location of branching is 1 and 2, right? 1, 2, dichloro, cyclopropane. Can I say this is also 1, 2 chlorine atom. So 1, 2 dichloro, the parent compound, 3 carbons, cyclic. Cyclopropane. So far, both names are identical except for one thing. In one case, we have the two branching on the same side. In the other case, the two branchings are on opposite side. So can I say opposites are trans? And same side. We name it as cis. So this is cis 1, 2 dichloro cyclopropane. And this one is trans 1, 2 dichloro cyclopropane. There is a compound which has got cis and trans. Trans is used for cancer, as medication for cancer. The cis is a poison. All atoms are identical. Everything is the same except for these two. So arrangement in three-dimensional space means a lot when we are dealing with medications and pharmaceuticals. And reactivity, chemical activity, biological activity, physical properties are different. These are things that we haven't talked about when we talk about general chemistry and inorganic chemistry. When you come to organic, these are very important. So go ahead, pause the video and name these. Then look at the answer, see if you did them okay. Come and see me if they don't make sense to you. Do these make sense? Trans for opposites. 1, 2 for location. Dibromo for two substituent. Parent compound is cyclic, has 3 carbon cyclopropane. In this case, the 2 chlorine are on the top of the plane of the ring, so they are cis, and they are not adjacent to each other. They are 1, 3, 2 chlorine dichloro, 4 atoms of carbon in the ring, so cyclobutane. Can I say in this case, we have the 2 branching on opposite side, 1 above, 1 below the ring of compound. So they are trans. And I'm going to call bromo number 1, chloro number 3, because alphabetic order B comes before C, of course. So can I say it's 1 bromo, 3 chloro, how many carbons in the ring? 5. It's the closed ring, cyclopentane, and the location of these 2, chlorine is above the plane of molecule, bromine is below, so we call it trans, opposite side. I hope this makes sense. If it doesn't, come and see me, please. So what is the usage of alkane? Well, of course, every day, we are driving our cars using gasoline. Gasoline is obtained from alkane. In our gasoline, we are using C5 to C15. It starts from pentane, straight chain pentane, hexane, heptane, octane. You remember octane number shows how effective, how efficient your gasoline is. And nonane and decane all the way to heavier hydrocarbons up to 15. And more number of hydrocarbons are in diesel and jet fuels. They have higher boiling point, your longer chains. And when you have got alkane, which have got more carbon, of course they become solid at room temperature. So the waxy coating, natural coating on the fruit is a mixture of alkane above 16 carbons. And that's why apples have got more shelf lives, longer shelf lives. They are protected by waxy coating. And if they are used in food chain industry to be washed to get rid of the pesticides, sometimes they reapply and spray a waxy coating of 16 carbon alkane and higher. So where do we get all the alkanes? Of course, from crude oil. How? By separating different components. So you preheat the raw petroleum, crude oil. It goes into a fractionating column. As the hot crude oil comes here, the lighter components which have lower boiling point, they have higher pressure, they move up. And we have an outlet which is going to separate, connected to different tank. This is natural gas, of course, which is methane, the lightest component of petroleum. And the heavier, the longer chain alkane, which have got a boiling point between 30 to 200 Celsius, there is an outlet here. You're collecting this as a gasoline. As you go further down this fractionating tower, you have higher boiling points. In this case, you get kerosene and jet fuel. Another layer of even higher boiling point, you get diesel fuel and heating oil. And higher than that, you're separating lubricating oil. And the bottom of the tower, you get asphalt and tar. So these are, this is distillation of crude petroleum. The same method that we use for measuring the amount of the acid. No, actually we didn't do this distillation. This semester, we didn't get to do distillation of the petroleum. I don't want to bother you at the end of the semester by giving you one more lab. But you did one distillation, separating of the component was simply done by the components of the mixture have different boiling points. You can, if you have a mixture of different boiling point substances, you can separate them by their boiling point. It's called fractional distillation. So on the next slide, when we talk about usage of alkane, unfortunately, we are using it for producing energy, fossil fuel and energy. Polluting our environment, destroying the valuable alkane, petroleum, which has come to us from million years of chemical and bacterial changes. Hopefully, we will make more progress to create more renewable sources of energy, to keep the alkanes, to make pharmaceutical products, to use them as the raw material for organic synthesis. Anyway, combustion, if I say combustion, the word combustion means reaction of organic compound with oxygen. And in this chapter, we are talking about alkane, which contains carbon and hydrogen. So carbons are converted to carbon dioxide. Hydrogens are burning, reacting with oxygen. They are converted to water, and a lot of energy is produced in the combustion, as you know. So then that's one of the usage of alkane. When we are doing barbecue, we're using propane. Reaction with oxygen producing carbon dioxide and water is called combustion. Looks like it's time to stop at this point. On our next session, we will discuss how to balance a combustion reaction. Of course, you have done this before. Refresh your memory of balancing combustion reactions. Thank you guys, and all the best. Have a wonderful day.